release.
God is good. Amen. And all the time, God is good. I know you're excited to worship the Lord this morning. So is the worship team. But before we start, I would like us to quieten our hearts. Let's not concern ourselves with the wars of the day or even for the coming week. But let's just focus on God this morning. Amen. I would like us to read a scripture. During my preparation time, the Lord spoke to me about this verse, and I would like to share with you. It says in Psalms 28, verse 7, "The Lord is my strength and shield. I trust Him with all my heart. He helps me, and my heart is filled with joy. I burst out in songs of thanksgiving." Amen. So that's my encouragement for us this morning, as per the Word of God, that let's burst out in songs of thanksgiving this morning. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, God, for today, Lord. We bless you. We thank you for who you are in our lives. And as we focus on you this morning, God, we pray for your Holy Spirit to come upon us. Visit us, sweet Holy Spirit, your presence in this place, oh God. Be with us this morning, Lord. Hallelujah.
We
Put your hands together. The same again. I can never return. I've closed the door. I will walk the path, I'll run the race, and I will never be the same again. I will never be the same again. I can never return. I've closed the door. I will walk the path, I'll run the race, and I will never be the same again. For like fire, so like rain, flow like mighty waters again. Hebrews 10:19 says, "And so, dear brothers and sisters, we can come boldly enter heaven's most holy place because of the blood of Jesus. By his death, Jesus opened a new and living way through the curtain into the most holy place." And as we sing this song, I just would like us to appropriate, to claim the power of the blood of Jesus. No matter what you're going through this morning, a sickness, a problem, a trial in your life, the blood of Jesus has power. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Lift up your hands, church. Just worship him this morning. I was a wretch. I remember who I was. I was lost, I was blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, the breach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you bade me in your sight.
So you made a way across the great divide, left behind heaven's door to build it here inside. There at the cross, you paid the debt I owed, broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time I had hope.
Thank you, Jesus, for the blood. Buried for 3 days, and then you walk right out again.
And now death has no sting, and life has no end. For I have been transformed by the blood of the Lamb.
Yes, hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus, for the blood.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I love that song, and it's true, I will never be the same again. I'll never be the same again, in more ways than one, going into the new year. And today is actually the first day of Chinese New Year, right? Yeah, there's a whole bunch of them that are saying Gong Hi Fa Choy because they're saying it because they're hoping. In the Chinese culture, when children go up to their parents and they say Gong Hi Fa Choy, they are putting their hands out. They're expecting a red packet with money inside. In Canada, we say Gong Hi Fat Chance. So it's a different tradition, but really it's Chinese New Year today. And I've got a Chinese New Year message for you, which is interesting because I'm Chinese and in my 65 years of life and over 50 years of ministry, I've never preached a sermon on Chinese New Year before, seriously, which is kind of strange, but you know, it fits right into my series, what I've been preaching as I've been studying and reading the 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians, and we've been doing our sermon series on that. So I want to share with us some thoughts about that. But before I do, let's just pray as ask the Lord to anoint us, to speak to us. Father, we're so glad you're here by your Spirit. We're so glad that you've given us a new life. We're so glad that you've given us a new family. And so, Lord, we say our lives will never be the same again because of Jesus. And we celebrate you, oh God. We worship you and we serve you in Jesus' name. Amen. Part 4, prepared for new things. Well, today I'm going to teach you some more Chinese. Is that okay? It's always good to learn a new language. They're already preparing for the Chinese New Year celebration. Quite a number of the Surrey members have really gone to our Vancouver service, and I taught them some Chinese there. And, in our celebration, Pastor Gerald is going to teach them a Chinese New Year song. And you know what? Pastor Gerald's Chinese is even worse than mine. So you can imagine what's going to happen after this. We're going to have lots of fun. My text is from 2 Corinthians 5. But this series, we started with 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9, which is our entire sermon series. Eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor have it entered into the heart of men and women the things which God has prepared for those who love Him. So God has prepared for us new things. And it's for the largest population in the world. It's a new day today. Today is officially Chinese New Year, Lunar New Year in the lunar calendar. So it's a new day for many of them. They woke up today and they're so excited. So many new things about it. But you know, as Christians in Christ, you can expect new things. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, which is my text, and I will be following the text throughout the sermon, it says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, are you in Christ this morning? Amen. It says, he or she is a new creation. You are new. The old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. So, you know, if you're a husband and wife, and if you did something wrong, don't use old excuses. Don't use old excuses. Because the Bible says, you are new. So, you know, your new creation, everything should be new. God will give you strength to do over some of those things that we did before that we could not do. And of course, you know, for me, we sang that song, I Will Never Be the Same Again. After all my surgery, after 2022, let me say it, I will never be the same again. You know, I will never be the same again because it's so different. My whole life is so different from then. Yes, I have the same Lord and Savior, but He's given me a new day. He's given me a new passion. He's given me a new urgency to share. And, you know, God has just been helping me to recover, get stronger, and He's been setting the agenda for me. You know, in the past, I have to track down ministries and help people and rescue people, but of late, God's just been literally putting them at my doorstep. You know, I'm getting phone calls, I'm getting people who I don't know asking for ministry. And it's been powerful. It's been amazing. You know, one of those that I ministered last Sunday, I asked you to pray because I was going to go after two services. I had to go out to Coquitlam, you know, I have a meeting with Brother Bramley and a group of them, and we had lunch. And by the time I was done, I rushed back to Vancouver to pray for a woman that I don't know, because I got a call from her daughter, another woman who I don't know. until that first phone call, and she said, could you come? My mother is dying, and no pastor would come to pray for her. And I said, sure, you know, if you don't mind waiting, I will make time. I will come, but I have to, you know, I really have to preach on Sunday, two services. I have another appointment that I really agreed to, you know, from weeks ago. I'll come right after. And so I went last week, and I got there, and praise God, her mother was still alive. But I just felt like to share my story about my miracle. And it's a new thing, you know, I've never had to like respond to a stranger and then go to a place where you're so urgent. And so I shared my whole entire story about my miracle. You know, my cancer healing, my life-saving procedure, and all of them, you know, some of them started crying, and all of them were in really listening. And then I addressed the mother who was in her last moments, literally breathing her last. And I shared with her that Jesus, you know, did a miracle in my life. Jesus not only can do a miracle, Jesus wants to save you. And I shared the gospel, and I led her in prayer. You know, she was, her eyes were closed, but I found out today, because the woman who called me her daughter this morning came to our church. Because of that, just me going there with Sister Kim to pray, she came today, and she said, you know something? I want you to know this, no pastor responded. You responded, you came, you shared with us your miracle, you shared with us about Jesus. And at the end, when you prayed that prayer and asked my mom to respond in her heart to the Lord, tears came down her eyes. See, in her last breath, her mother was praying. And although she was not praying with her mouth, she was crying and responding and grabbing onto her hand to let her know that this is what I want. You know, and today she came, you know, and she shared with me that right after I prayed for her, shared with them, after I left, when I went out of the room, the mother went to be with the Lord, just like that. And I thought to myself, wow, God is so amazing, you know. And she said, you know what, I was telling my mother, wait, because the doctors had told her the mother would pass midnight that night, like so many hours before. And she told her mother, could you wait a little longer because the pastor is coming? I got a pastor to come and pray with you and share with you. And she waited. And when she prayed that prayer in her heart, after I left, she went back to be with God. You know, and I was thinking to myself, wow, it's so important, you know. And I'm so thankful that God gave me this new life. I'm so thankful that God gave this lady the new life. And that's what really it's all about. You know, Chinese New Year is not just about having a new year so that the past and the last year, all the bad things that happened can be washed away and you can have a fresh start. It's a new day every day. In Christ, you can expect new things with that new life that's given us. You know that they don't call it Chinese New Year in every country. There are a lot of countries that celebrate it. Some call it Lunar New Year celebrations because it's following the lunar calendar. That's why it's not 1st of January. It's the lunar calendar. Then there are others that call it Spring Festival. And actually the Chinese started Chinese New Year calling it Spring Festival. And it's in a sense appropriate because spring is when new life begins. Spring is when new life begins in the natural world. You know, I planted tulips and daffodils in the ground, and springtime, I can't wait for them to come up. So far, they've come up about 3 or 4 inches, a lot of those that I planted. And what was once dead, literally, you look at it and you're like, you know, this is dead. It's coming to life. And that's where they celebrate Chinese New Year. That's where they put all those, you know, they call it pussy willows, you know, tiny little branches with that fluffy little thing. They're basically saying that that's new life. This is a new day. This is a new year. And so part of that tradition is that, you know, Chinese, they'll have to sweep their house before Chinese New Year. Part of that is they have to do it before today. The moment Chinese New Year hits, after they have swept away all the bad luck, that's why they sweep and vacuum. The New Year, they're not allowed to sweep because you don't want to sweep away your good luck now. That's what they believe, right? So that's why if you go visit them, you see they got a new hairstyle, new haircut, new. And so it's to symbolize that it's a new beginning. And all the old, the bad luck which they believe in is all washed away. And that prosperity will be welcomed into their homes. And it's interesting because Chinese New Year is also known as Spring Festival. There's a Chinese word, you know, for spring that I want to teach you. Spring, if you can shoot it up, in Chinese is different from English. All your strokes have to be written in the correct manner. So in Chinese, let me teach you 1 to 4, okay? One is E. Can you say E? One stroke across. Two is er, two strokes. Er. And then three is, three strokes is E, er. San. Can you say san? So can you read E, er, san? E, er, san. Okay, so 1, 2, 3. So what is 4?
4.
4 is 4 strokes? No! And this is where they set you up for failure. You know, when I was learning Chinese, 1, 2, 3, I thought, oh, this is easy, right? 4 strokes left. No! 4 is 1 square and 2 funny characters this way. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4. But you know the word spring is 1, 2, 3, ear sun, symbolizing the triune God. And then after that, you write a word down this way, a character down this way, and another this way. And that word is ren, meaning man. So 3, triune God, with man, the Son of God, the Son of Man. And then underneath the 1, 2, 3, and then the man character is a character that's in a box and one line across. It means day or ru. So you have 3, the triune God, send the Son of God on the day of salvation, spring. It's very interesting. A lot of Chinese characters literally have biblical meanings in it, from like the boat, the character boat. On the left, the character is a vessel. On the right is 8 men, 8 mouths, meaning Noah, a boat with 8 mouths in it. If you count the number of people in Noah and his family, it was 8. So there's a lot of interesting truths that you can get from that. And so really, you know, when Chinese are celebrating spring, a new year, they're hoping and they're searching for the new life, for the spring, for the new creation. And every year they're hoping for that. But Jesus had already done it, you know, and we have it. So even as we celebrate, we're thankful for that. Culture cannot redeem us. Good works cannot redeem us. Wealth cannot save us. Christ is the only answer. And so we see Spring Festival. And then red, you notice red. I don't have a bright red shirt. I told Pastor Art, let's dress like Chinese. I don't have any Chinese things. This is as red as I can get. Pastor Art is more Chinese than me. And then you see red packets, red banners. And it's interesting that red became such a symbol of the new year and the blessing. And if you look at every Chinese household, they will have a red banner over their door. A red banner over their door. Literally. And they don't realize that the red banner of their door literally is a repeat of the Passover. When God was taking Israel, you know, out of Egypt, he told them, paint the blood of the lamb over the doorpost. So when the angel of death will come, he will pass over and not, you know, and the people, the inhabitants will be safe. The Chinese, they have a similar thing. They put the banner there and they put a word, and the word is to drive out this god, this monster that's coming to kill them. And their god is called Nian. It's very interesting. They have it in their culture, but they don't understand. And they have no way of finding that salvation. And yet it's there, so clear for them. And so they go with red. So everything is red. You know, red outfit, red everything. But they don't realize red is the color of the blood of the Lamb. You know, the color that's painted on the doorpost that saves us. Then, of course, they do all these things because they want the good life, the prosperous life. Do you know that Chinese New Year, you're not allowed to wear old clothes? You know, When we were growing up, we were poor. Most families were poor. The only time we got new clothes was Chinese New Year. So the week before Chinese New Year, the parents would take the kids and go and buy them new clothes and say, you're not allowed to wear it until Chinese New Year morning. Because the new things, the new clothes, symbolize the new life. It welcomes the wealth that they are looking for. In fact, they're so into this new things and red things that, you know, the truth is that Victoria's Secret did not invent the red underwear. It was the Chinese who did that. You know, they designed the red underwear because they believe that every part of your body has to be covered with red. Because that will bring about that it will wash away all the old and bring about the new. Without understanding that God is telling them only the blood of Christ. So many people say that clothes make the man or the woman. To mean that dressing well helps people to be successful. And a lot of cultures do that. They dress them very well, although they are very poor. I went to Africa quite a number of years ago, and I realized, wow, very poor society. But you know, when they go to church on Sunday, or when they have a celebration, oh my goodness, they dress up so nicely. They can barely afford the clothes, but they will dress their kids, they will dress themselves so nicely, because this is what they want in their lives. They want to attract the successful life, the wealth that's in them. And they forget that it's not just about the good life. And they don't realize that, you know, God has provided for us the abundant life more than the good life. And that's the reason why, you know, if you realize this, if you have some Chinese friends, and I'm telling you this, you know, not as a fairy tale, but it's true. Do you know that Chinese, that's the reason why most Chinese want to live in Richmond? Because it's rich. In rich land. They even call their children Richard because of rich. You know, and anything to do with wealth because they want to attract. They want that. They think that that's what life is all about, the good life. And in every culture, in every country, we have our own good life. American dream, some call it. You know, the Canadian dream or Canadian lifestyle, whatever it's called. Every country has their own. In Singapore, we have our own. You know, one wife, two children, you know, three bedrooms, four wheels. That's what every Singaporean in their mind, you know, that's a good life. If we have all those things, we have it made. If you have nice clothes to wear, you have it made. And so today, many are still pursuing the good life. So every Chinese New Year, when you see them putting on the new clothes, you know, they are really seeking for something that they cannot find except in Christ. They don't realize God has given us abundant life, eternal life. You know, and throughout mankind's existence, that has always been an issue. Do you know that with Adam, it's like Adam, when Adam sinned, you know what's the first thing he did? He realized he was naked. And so he went and he sewed fig leaves to cover himself. So when God came, he went and hid because he realized that even though I cover my nakedness, I'm still naked before God and I'm vulnerable. And that's what humanity has constantly been looking. We're looking for something in our natural world to make up for what we don't have within ourselves. Maybe not being able to be a success story, not being able to live a life that I feel like, you know, I'm good enough. And God will accept me. So it's like Adam who sinned, realized he needed clothes to cover his nakedness, and used leaves. And still, he was not able to. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, back to my text again, verse 1 to 5. It says, for we know that if our earthly house, this tent, is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens, for in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed. I didn't come up with this. This is there. Desiring to be clothed with a habitation which is from heaven. Even in Chinese New Year, they're trying to clothe themselves with something new, something clean, something that will bring them what they don't have yet. And Paul says, if indeed having been clothed, we shall not be found naked, for we who are in this tent groan, being burdened, not because we want to be unclothed, but we want to be further clothed. Because we realize what we wear, what we do, no matter what, how successful we look like, or we feel, or we really are, we still are vulnerable and inadequate. And Paul says that's inbuilt in all of us. So Chinese New Year is a good time when you see people dress up in new, you know, it's a good chance to use that as a talking point. You know, yes, you know, it's great. But you know the Bible says this, quote 2 Corinthians chapter 5, because we want to be clothed with the robes of righteousness, because we lost that. Adam was looking for that. He lost that in the Garden of Eden. You know, and that's so important. And it's interesting. If you notice, in a lot of homes, they'll see a red-colored paper that they paste in the house during Chinese New Year, or they're hanging up. And it's the word Fu, meaning prosperity. On the left, the first character is God. And then on top, the first character is one cold mouth in a garden. God with one mouth in the garden. Who is that? Adam, you know? And really, it's interesting because that same Chinese word in the Chinese Bible is used 533 times. And the Chinese are posting this red things all over. You go TNT, you see it everywhere, the Chinese character. And they're saying, we want that. We want this life. We want to be clothed. We want to find our place in this life. And they're chasing after all these things. And God has done it through His Son. You know, God has done it. And so He has clothed us. And then, of course, the next thing that I want to talk about is that during this season, during Chinese New Year, they have the greatest thing they call reunion dinner. Last night, most families did the reunion dinner. They want to be reunited with their family. And God has reunited us with Father God. Do you know that this time of the year is the greatest migration of people, of humanity, at any time of the season? They say that in China alone, 500 million people were on the move last week. 500 million! I mean, China has 1.4 billion people. About half their population was on the move. Why? Because they work all over the world, work all over China. They normally don't work where they live. They love to live in the cities and work in the city, and then they go home to where their families. And so when Chinese New Year comes, they shut down their factories, their shops for 1 week, and they travel. All the flights are booked, all the trains are booked. If you don't book early, you literally have to ride a bicycle home for hundreds of miles. And they rush home for their reunion dinner, because to them, that's the biggest thing. Family. To be with their family, to enjoy the food together, and to live out their prosperity and life. And so that's part of the celebration. That's where all the restaurants, you know, they are filled before Chinese New Year, and then after Chinese New Year, they close so that they can have their time with their family. And yet in the Bible, it tells us that there's the ultimate reunion dinner. In Psalm 23, verse 5 to 6, it says, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. It sounds like Chinese on Chinese New Year, literally. You know, all the things that they look for, but it's right there before their eyes. But most people don't see it. And God is preparing for us, ultimately. One day, I look forward to this. One day, when this whole world comes to an end, when Jesus returns again, there will be a gigantic reunion dinner in heaven where all of us will sit down. You know, there's something about food, something about eating meals together that is so intimate, that is so special. And that's where Jesus, when He was around, when He was ministering, He sat and ate with anybody, because you realize that's the time where you share, when you are intimate, when you do that which is basic yet important. One of the most important facets of family life together. And that's why they call Jesus the glutton, because He would sit down and eat with them. And the most sacred thing that we do in churches, any kind of churches, every type of denomination, is the communion. And what's the communion? Food again, breaking the bread, the wine, you know. And God basically is telling us that that's what He's bringing us all together one day. Every tribe, every color, every language, all those who know the Lord Jesus Christ, all those that have been saved by the blood, washed by the blood of the Lamb, we'll all be gathered up one day. And we'll have the ultimate reunion dinner to celebrate God's goodness. And God has put us in the new family. You know, family is important. I miss my reunion dinner with my own family. They just sent me today photographs of all their, you know, what they ate and everything else. And it was so interesting because Christmas, they invited me to, and they said, each member of the family bring a certain item. Can you put down what you want? And so every family member said, oh, you know, I'll prepare this food. I'll buy this food. I'll bring this food. And I sent from here a picture. So I said, I'll send curry puffs because I know curry puffs is my favorite, you know. And I miss that. But God has put us in a bigger family, in a new family. And that's where we celebrate. Because there's something within all of us that seeks that. You know, we seek something that's more than ourselves. We are made not to be alone. We are made to be put in a family. And so when God redeems us, He puts us in a bigger family. And of course, finally, the next point is that it's not just a new life. It's not just a new day that God has given us. It's a new calling. It's a brand new calling. The old is gone. The Bible says, behold, I make all things new. Before you became a Christian, you know, you have your old values, you have your old dreams, you had your old idea of what you should be doing, what you want in your life. But when He saved you, when you became a Christian, God has something new for you, a new calling in your life. And 2 Corinthians 5 verse 20 says, now then we are ambassadors for Christ. Ambassadors for Christ. As though God was pleading through us, we implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God, for He made Him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in Him. Do you know that you are ambassadors? You are a representative of God. You know, that's where how you dress, how you talk, how you walk, how we live our lives. An ambassador can't just go out there and get drunk. A few years ago in Singapore, there was an ambassador of Romania. And he didn't represent his country very well because he'll go out partying and get drunk. And one night he was driving home and he ran over an old lady and he killed that old lady. And because he was an ambassador, he had diplomatic immunity. So you can't charge him. But he brought so much disgrace to his country. You know, he was asked to leave the country the next day because they couldn't do anything about it. They knew he was drunk. The police, when they were there, he was drunk. He couldn't even stand up. Yeah, he was driving the diplomatic car, and he killed the woman. And, you know, he brought so much disgrace, they never allowed him, ever. He went back to Romania, and he was never allowed again to be part of that representative of the country. No longer again was he an ambassador. And that's our calling, too. So what does your new calling require? Your new calling requires faith principles. Faith values that will guide and direct your new life and calling. 2 Corinthians 5:7 says, we walk by faith, not by sight. In other words, we don't live our lives like the rest of the world. How? Like for instance, when a doctor tells you, you got cancer, you're going to die, most people say, well, if the doctors cannot do anything, that's living by faith, I prepare to die. But not us Christians. When the doctor told me, well, you know, you got stage 4, that's the end. I still believe, and you still believe, that God can do healing. Because we live by faith, not by sight. You know, and the way we live our lives is different from the world. And the world needs to see, because we are representatives of God. They need to see that we are people of love. Because you are chosen. You are called to represent the kingdom of God. A lot of people wonder, why is it that in Korea, Christians have been so effective? In the last 60 years, they brought their country from like virtually a totally 100% Buddhist country to one that has something like 20-something, 30% evangelical Pentecostal Christians. And let me share with you, yes, it's true that God raised up many men, mighty men and women in their country, but one of the secrets of the church in Korea is this. It's not just the size of the church. It's not just the anointing on the man of God, it's the average Christian. You know, there's a man of God that God raised as one of the earliest pioneers of that principle is a cell group. And their cell group is not just a Bible study group. Their cell group is literally a lighthouse and a rescue place in every community. They started with some. And every cell group member in Korea have been taught this lesson, that every single one of my neighbor is someone that I want to help, someone that I would lay down my life for. And they literally do that. They'll go out, they'll buy things for them, they'll help them. If someone is sick, they'll go visit them. And slowly through time, it became a culture in the cell groups and the churches in Korea that people who live in those areas around these cell groups, and more started growing as a result. People who live around those cell groups know that if I have an emergency, if my child is in hospital, if I run out of food, if I have a problem in my life, they know where to go. They know where the cell groups are. They know who are the Christians. They'll go to the Christians. It became such a thing that it's just normal there. They'll go to them and say, you know, I need help. And then the cell group will come in and they'll help them. And then another person gets saved, another cell group gets started with the same love, the same attitude, and they keep doing that because they take it very seriously. That's the principle that they live by. Love God, love your neighbor. And they literally go out their way. And that's where today, in many of the churches, on one Sunday morning, like in Dr. Cho's church, you know, Dr. Cho has he pioneered in the church, you know, he retired, he failed in his ministry, done in life, he was caught up in money and all that, but he started something that was good. Do you know that every week in that church in Korea, just one church, over 1 million people attend, nowhere around the world. And there are many other churches, 100,000, 200,000 people attend every Sunday morning, not just because of the preacher, because of every member who knows, I am an ambassador, I'm chosen, I'm called by God, I represent the kingdom of God, I represent my Jesus. So they love people that way. They love people that way. And that's how they became so effective. So how will I fulfill the calling? For the love of Christ compels me. This is what I'm talking about. 2 Corinthians 5. For the love of Christ compels us. It compels us. When you truly love somebody, you know, and that's where this morning when this new member came, because I responded, she said this to me. She said, I called so many pastors. Every pastor told me, I don't know you. I'm not coming. And when she called me, I said, yes, okay, I will come. My schedule is very busy, but I will come. We'll have to pray that your mom will survive that long. I have to squeeze it in, but that's how I did it. And so today when she came, she said, I'm joining your church. I'm a member of your church now. Because you cared when nobody cared. And I'm not saying it to say that I'm special. I'm not. I'm like you. The love of Christ compels. The love of Christ compels. And that same love that he loved us with is in your heart. You have that same love. You showed that same love to me during my time of need. You know, if you show that same love to your neighbor, let me say this. Many of your neighbors will follow you to church. Many of your neighbors will come to know the Lord eventually. The love of Christ compels. The love of God in you will cause people to seek you out. They will call you. You know, on top of that, somebody called me and said, you know, can you talk to this person in Malaysia that has cancer? I don't know who this person is. I know he's not a Christian. I don't know his background. He doesn't know me. I just asked, does he want prayer? Does he want a pastor to talk to him? Because I don't want to surprise him as a stranger. And so I said, if he wants, get him to just call me, right? And so the person contacted me and he called me long distance, you know, a week ago. And he said, can you pray for me? I've had cancer, he said. So I found out he has the same cancer as me. I found out that he flew out to Singapore and paid a lot of money to have the same surgery as me. So when he was trying to explain, I said, I know what that is. I explained to him. He said, how do you know? I said, I had the surgery. And I shared with him my miracle. And so this guy, he was so shocked. He's like, wow, God must have sent you to talk to me. You know, and he's been, you know, I prayed for him. He went through another surgery just yesterday. He's been texting me, keeping in touch with me. I pray with him, and I'm praying with him, and I promise him I'll walk with him through this. The love of Christ. God will open up doors. These people are searching. They're looking for people who will care for them. They're looking for people who are like them, Maybe not going exactly through what they have gone through, but he found me, and I've gone through exactly what he's going through now. And he was so surprised that God can match him up with a person about the same age, except he doesn't know the Lord. And so now I'm sharing him the love of God. You know, that's a testimony of the power of God to change lives, to heal. And when you share that testimony, when you share what you have received, then God will draw people. It will draw people to you. So don't stop that. Just continue to love. And finally, I can do all things. I can do all things. Philippians 4:13 says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. He gave us a new life. He gave us a new calling. And you know what? He gave us a new power through his Holy Spirit. I can't do all these things by myself. My wife is worried about me. Members are concerned because they know that lately I've been on this very hectic schedule. I didn't set up all these things. I didn't plan to run around ministering to so many people. But God has been helping me to get stronger. And as I get stronger, God has been lining them up, literally. Lining them up. I'm flying back to Singapore in May. From Singapore, I'm flying to Cambodia, Cambodia to Thailand, Thailand to India for ministry. And we planned it because God showed me this is what I want you to do. But you know what? I haven't even let people know. I only let one brother know that I'm flying back in May. And I already have an invitation to preach in a church of 5,000 in Singapore. God's just lining it up. And people are seeking me up. Strangers are saying, would you come? Nobody else will respond. And that's the sad part. Nobody else will respond. So I want to challenge you. Respond. Ask God, God, here I am. Send me. Use me, God. Because there are a lot of people out there who are Christians who won't do it. Because they have their own life that they're pursuing, their own families. But I know that God has called us. God has called you. God has given you that love. And God will expand the capacity in your life. And that God will use His Holy Spirit to bless each one of you so that you will say, like me, I can do all things in Christ who strengthens me. It's a new day. It's a new calling. It's a new power that God promises us. Let me pray for you this morning as I close. Hallelujah. Father, you are true to your word. Jesus, before you left, you gave us a commandment to go into all the world, preach the gospel, make disciples. Father, we want to take the commandments, the Great Commission, seriously. And so, Lord, we pray, oh God, Lord, use me. Use me, oh God. This morning, where you're seated, I want you to know that if you make yourself available, God will begin to open doors. God will begin to send people your way. And so you need to be prepared. You need to prepare to know what to say to them. Share about what God has done in your life. Share about what God has done in your pastor's life. What God has done in this church. Get ready. Because God is going to send people your way. Because I've been praying. And now I'm asking you to pray the same prayer with me. So Lord, I pray, send. Send the needy. Send those who are searching. Send those who are hurting, oh God. Send those, oh God, with nobody to turn to, oh God. Send them to your precious children here. And enlarge our hearts with love. Compel us. We ask you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. The Lord bless you.
The first Chinese two words I learned, because I grew up in a slum area in Quiapo, there's no sound. There's no sound. I grew up in a small area in Quiapo and I only learned two words. In Quiapo, all the stores there are Chinese owned. Everybody's Chinese and they're married to a Filipina and there's about 10 kids in every family. I learned Kosing Gaulo. Kosing Gaulo. In Tagalog, Singkong Lugaw. Because we have to buy food, right? Praise God. Can we call the ushers for your tithes and offering? Can we play Cambodia before I call up Aida and Charon to do the introduction? Don't forget to reach your information for your tax receipt. We have to make sure that you fill up it properly. Also, we'd like to extend our condolences to Mike Chris for the grandmother passed away recently. And if you have not signed up yet for Christmas or for Chinese New Year in Vancouver, it's too late. Sorry, we're going to be there and we're going to sing, PG and I and Pastor Gerald will sing a Chinese song. All right, for you guys. Make sure that you will not be there because you did not sign up. But some of them are going there and they're rushing. They want me to finish this quickly. Can we play it, please? I forgot. So this is where, you know, we collected our funds for Cambodia. Our children, you donated something. This is where it went. Watch it. Guys bought some of them, it, this is what happened. They're blessed. So let's keep on doing it, right? So let's just keep on doing it because we're blessing children who are not well-to-do in a third world. We are here, we're enjoying everything. So let's keep on really providing and helping and supporting these kinds of work. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, let's call up Britney Spears. Oh, Charlie's Angel.
Are you?
Hindi kayo. Okay, I forgot. They're not the ones who gonna dance. But you know what? Used to be, this couple works for Church's Chicken. Right? But because Jollibee came in, now they are the representative of Chicken Joy. Let's put our hands together, Edwin and Estelle.
I'd like to ask everybody, please stand up. Yes, I'd like you all to participate. There's only this dance, the chicken dance, is only the upper part of your body that moves. And there's only four moves. Okay? And this is also for our couples night.
With the stars, we already have 62 couples who registered. So that's 62 times 2 is 124. So we're almost full pack, right, Aida?
Yes.
Yes. And so the deadline of registration is until next week, January 29. Okay, so that's the last day of registration. So.
Okay, so yeah, so we just want to encourage you guys, if you haven't registered yet, to register because we only have a few tickets left. Yeah, so are you excited?
It's gonna be a fun night.
Yeah.
And we prepared a lot of awards, right?
Yes, really fun awards. So be here, make sure to catch those awards if you can.
Yes, we'll have fun. Thank you guys.
Bye.
Thank you.
And don't forget that after the service, we still have the dance class. They're gonna teach you today. They're gonna teach you swing and foxtrot. And Kuya Alec will be there. What time?
1:30.
So please be back and learn some steps. And some of you who can't come today, we still have Thursday night, and we're teaching cha-cha. Is it Thursday night? So please come. All right. Let's all stand up for prayer. Father, we thank you, Lord, that in you, every morning is new. Every morning we wake up, it's always a new morning, and your steadfast love is so evident. We pray, Lord, as we work this week and whatever endeavor we're doing, guide us, lead us, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you continuously help us, Lord, in whatever endeavor, Lord. We thank you, Lord, Holy Spirit, because you said you're not abandoning us, forsaking us, Lord. You will always be with us, Lord. And we pray, Lord, that you go before us, safety and protection for everyone, provision for all our needs, Lord. We just want to thank you and praise you and glorify your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you all. Let's go to Vancouver. Eat all the food.